Well, praise the Lord. It's so awesome to have you with us today. As we begin our service today, set our minds to worship and praise God. Give Him glory because He has brought us to this point that we can worship and praise Him. Sing along in our songs today. Amen.
We welcome you, Holy Spirit.
It's who you are, and I'm loved by you. Yes, it's who I am.
That's who I am. That's who I am. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect.
Day.
deserve the glory.
Sing it again.
Lord, you are worthy of it all.
Let's all put our hands together for the Lord today. My goodness, what an awesome song. Before you sit down, because we're still excited about getting an opportunity to get back together, and there's some today, this is your first time back with us. Others are still sort of trying to figure it out. Before we go any further, let's just take a moment. I'm not asked to get a hug, a neck, shake a hand. You can take your fist, you can hit them, or you can pump their fist, or whatever you want to do, and just turn and say good morning to somebody. Would you do that? Amen. Good morning, good morning. Praise team, you did an excellent job. Amen. Ushers, if you'll just make your way up here, we're about to take care of business. Amen. 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 He is worthy of all praise. Worthy of all praise. Isn't this beautiful? We hadn't had a chance to do this in a while. So we're just taking advantage, smiling, saying good morning. Amen. Amen. All right. If you'll just ease back over to your place and remain standing. I think Brother Mark Gray's got something he wants to talk about.
God bless you. I am so happy to see you folks. I've missed you so very much. I'm glad we're together again today. We'll just give God all the glory. I don't know one person that's sick. I know not one. I know bad things happen to good people, but God has his hand on his church. And nobody here is going to get sick, and nobody is going to die from this virus. God said that he'll keep that plague from our dwelling.
There you go.
And he means what he says. We're going to be just fine. I'm so glad to see you. I want to give God praise. I want to give him glory. Can we just give him a hand clap of praise? We're going to take a time to receive our tithes and offerings. Be blessed by God. Give him what's due him, and he will absolutely bless you. Thank you for being here today. Lord, we give you glory and honor and praise, for you deserve every bit that we can possibly give you and more. We honor you, Father. We thank you for who you are. We thank you for your precious Son, Jesus. Thank you for your Spirit, and thank you for my church family. We give you honor and glory and praise. Thank you, Lord. Amen.
One, two, three, turn it off. There you go. Let's give the Lord another thank you. Thank you for your generous giving. The tithers, that's God's part already. He just said, I'm going to put it in your trust and watch you do what's right. Then the offerings are left up to us. But did you know what the word offering means? It don't mean if you want to give it, it means sacrifice. Offering is offer. So thank you today. You're so faithful, even during the times when we weren't able to have our regular scheduled services like we're building up to. You made sure, and so many of you, that your support was here. We have electronic means now. Go to our webpage, the Iville Christian Assembly, and you'll find a button you can mash that's tithely. If you want to add an extra million to your giving next week, just hit the button and write it. Hey, according to your faith, I'm thinking big stuff here today, but thank you so much. And if you don't have any to give, but Jesus is the main thing in your life, bless you and thank you. Glad you're here this morning. We have a precious dear lady that was here, her and her family, I don't know, 2 or 3 years now, Sister Bone? 3 years ago. Her and her husband was here, and she had a son that was living here, and they moved off. And while they've been gone, he passed away, and we're sorry about your loss. But she's moved back, come back home. Let's welcome Sister Rosemary back home today. And those of you, this is your first time back to our services since the virus started. We're just delighted you're here. Everybody, my son and his daughters, my granddaughters are here visiting with us from over in Shreveport, Louisiana. And Brother Robert Pewitt is been in the hospital for several days, but he's here. He did not have the virus. He was just sick, okay? And he's here today with us, and we're all just celebrating together. And love you very, very much. Welcome to you that are watching us, that have tuned in to us today. This is the Iberville Christian Assembly. We're just a local church in the little city outside of the city of Biloxi on the beautiful Gulf Coast of Mississippi. And if you've turned the knob and you say, who these people are, we're a local church that God has shown his mercy, his blessings, and his glory. And I have been called and chosen many years ago to be the pastor, and I'm telling you, it has been an honor. I am the under-shepherd of God to one of the most beautiful flocks, spiritually speaking, that any pastor could have the privilege to serve. They love me and I love them, and we've seen wonderful things. And yes, we've had lots of empty pews for a good while because of the pandemic, but now we're seeing the pews beginning to fill. And we hope in just a little while we'll have to say to the ushers, all right, ushers, get the chairs out here. Somebody needs a place to sit down. But you're here today, and you're watching wherever you are. Welcome to our service. Now, my wife is blessed with a tremendous voice, and so she's going to share a song with us today. Yeah. And I'm not trying to make on over. I love her already. I mean, she loves me. So here she is.
Song was laid on my heart a couple of weeks ago, and I haven't sung it in a while, but it's for all of those. And Dolly, if you're listening, this song is for you, to comfort and for all of us who have lost a loved one. If they're a believer, we don't have to worry about them. We will see them again one day.
I dreamed of a city called glory, so bright and so fair. When I entered the gates, I cried, holy. The angels, they all met me there. They carried me from mansion to mansion, and all the sights I saw. But I said, I want to see Jesus. He's the one who died for all. Then I bowed on my knees and cried, holy. I cried, holy, holy. Then I clapped my hands and sang, glory. I sang glory to the Son of God. And as I entered the gates of that city, oh, all the streets of heaven, but the sights were too numerous to
that we serve. Holy. And so in that book called the Bible, there's a instruction of the word of the Lord that said, be ye holy, talking to us, as I am holy. That's a very interesting tidbit of instructions. Now, I can't be as God now, but he's given me an opportunity to do the best that I can under my human circumstances and the challenges of life. And he deserves me to live in such a way that my life says to him, thank you for what you did. Jesus came here, rose from the dead after great suffering and death, and ascended into the heavens with some promises that he'll meet us in the clouds. While he's away, said he's working for us. He said, I go to my Father's house. I prepare for you a place. And so one day, we'll see it. We'll have to have a new body to see it. Eyes not seen, ears not heard, the things that God hath prepared for them that love him. And I know the rest of the scripture said, but by his Spirit, his revealed, there may be moments in your life where you think you saw a glimpse of a gold street or pearly gate or foundations, etc. But once we get this new body, and by the way, it won't just have eyes to see. It will be perfect in every sense of the word. No headaches. No troubles, no tears, no pain. Can you just imagine? Well, there are so many benefits as being a believer and serving the Lord, and they cover every spectrum of our imagination. And so today, we're here celebrating our love for the Lord. Now, church is the building is not the church. This building was dedicated. People put their hands on the pews, the walls, the instruments, you see. And we agreed many, many years ago that this place would be dedicated for for a place to worship the Almighty God. But we went through a couple of months recently where there weren't many able to be here. But that didn't mean that our love for God and our worship of the Lord ceased. As a true believer, whether we were able to get into the building or not, we have a relationship with Jesus Christ, and our love for him goes beyond the buildings. We're here, a couple of hours on Sunday, and we leave. The lights go out, the doors are locked, and we're out of here. Wednesday night, we do have a 7 o'clock service. We'd love for you to join us. We have live streaming as well as one-on-one now. We're able to come in and have service on Wednesday just like we are here. We sing, we visit, we take prayer requests, we give on Wednesday night we give the old-fashioned testimony services. So if you miss that and you wonder what that is, tune us in Wednesday nights at 7, or just come on over and be a part of us. But in the meantime, we know that Jesus Christ is in us, the hope of glory, okay? And so whatever's going on, we know that we have hope in the Lord. However, at the same time, as pastor, I am very well aware of some of the devil's devices. Now, I know what he's done in the past. I don't know what he's going to do in the future. He has a lot of conniving, deceptive, evil things that he has done. And he knows that his time to come against the church and cause havoc in society is very short-lived now. Time is running out. Do you believe that today? Time is about to run out as we know it. And so he's pulling all the stops. I'm sure he's given clear instructions and commands to all the demons, and it has been estimated that falling with him from heaven were about 50 million angels. That's not my number. I don't know that number, but by people who study numbers and Bible and history, 50 million plus or minus a few million demons that are here on the earth. And by the way, all the demons that are here this morning, we don't see you, but you decided you wanted to try to come and check us out. Let me remind you, it won't be too long. You're going to be cast into a lake of fire, and you're going to pay for your rebellion against God, and you're going to pay for all the harm you've done to God's people and the earth that God made. You're going to pay dearly for it. So if you want to stick around and hear me talk more about the judgment of God on you demons, you stay. I prefer you leave, but that's left up to you. Got plenty to say. Amen. The devil is as bold. And why shouldn't we be? We have the power of God. And the Lord said we have authority. And when we speak and when we bind, it says, in the name of Jesus, the Lord said, heaven agrees with us. Are we afraid to use the authority that God has given us? According to this book, whatsoever you bind on earth, I'll bind it in heaven. Whatever you loose, I'll loose. So you and I today have so much to be thankful for that now there are times when the Lord has allowed a demon to maybe get a little closer than at normal times, or to come against us from the blind side, or maybe just to show up and create havoc. But let me remind you, the Lord said, I will not allow any more to come up on you than you're able to bear. But with every temptation or situation that you may be experiencing now or may experience later, he said, I will provide an escape route for you. I will show you the way out, and you will see that I am with you. So ladies and gentlemen, in the building or wherever you may be, the God that I'm talking about is able to help you through your situation. You may feel like you're in a dark tunnel and there is no light and you're not sure which way to go. Just stand on the word of the Lord. On Christ, the solid rock, we stand. Believe me today, Satan has lied. He's done a lot of lying. In fact, he's done a lot of lying to God's people. And some of the lies he's told have become what I want to talk about this morning, distractions. If anyone should walk in peace, it should be you, and you and you, me. All of God's people. He said, I did not give you the spirit of fear, but of what? Power and love and a sound mind. Sometimes the devil will press you and then he'll put a thought in your mind. You're losing your mind. Oh, I'm losing. I've heard believers say, I feel like I'm losing my mind. That's just another way that Satan is trying to manipulate a believer and giving themselves over to him. I have Jesus, and he's the Lord of my life. He filled me with a baptism of the Holy Ghost with the evidence of speaking in other tongues. And I'm going to tell you, he said, you shall receive power after the Holy Ghost has come upon you. I have power through the name of Jesus, and I don't have to be afraid to exercise that authority. Everybody say authority. You don't have to be a pushover. He wants us to believe that we are. He wants us to believe in our thoughts that he can just come in and create all kind of things that he wants to. My concern today as a minister, as a pastor, that far too many of God's people have been taken advantage of and been manipulated by things that are actually lies. Now, when this virus, we got word that it was in the area a few months back, we did something very bold. And everybody that was here that day on Sunday came and stood across the front. We have a little box that we keep handy. In this box are pieces of cloth, linen cloth. They're cut in about, I don't know, 3x3 pieces, sizes. We keep them here behind the pulpit. And often people come and say, Pastor, I'd like to have a prayer cloth anointed. And whoever's around, elders in the church or people who are people of prayer, we will just reach in the box, take out a cloth, put it in your hand, and then we will take the oil. Right here. We will take the oil and touch the cloth and speak over it. Now, there is no healing, no power in the oil. Neither is there healing and power or power in the cloth. But in agreement, you say, I've asked for the covering of the Lord. I've asked for the protection, for the anointing of the Lord. There are people in this building today that told me just recently that they took the cloth that they received that day when we jammed the front of this building and everybody received the cloth and we anointed it and they took it home. It included when they walked out of the door of this building and they got in their car, they were in a car protected by the Lord. They would go home. Their home would be protected and blessed of God. They would go to work and they would be protected by the Lord. They would go to the store and no harm. And it also included the covering of their family. Now I'm talking to you that didn't know about this, that are watching or here today as well as watching. We believe in the power of prayer. And so there are those in this building right now that still carry maybe in their wallet or on their person the cloth that was anointed and prayed over, and we invoked the power of the name of Jesus. I'm glad to say not one of our church members, not one, has come close to being a victim of this virus that they tell us now that in the United States over 100,000 people have died from. I believe in the covering of the Lord. I believe in agreement where two or more. So we stood here and we agreed together and we prayed together with anointed cloths. Now, Satan gets really upset with such things like that, because it messes him up. Because if he's not careful, he'll figure out that those people really believe in the divine covering of God. I do. Amen. But he's a thief. The devil's a thief, and he wants to steal my trust in the power of prayer. Kill. He's a killer. He wants to kill my thoughts of the Word of God. But whatever. On Christ, the solid rock, I stand all the time. Steal, kill, and destroy. That's who the enemy is. And so when we talked about it, and we just brought the subject up again, and here you are. You are blessed. You are protected. You are covered by the Lord. And let me say, you that are home and you've not gotten to the place that you feel that it's okay with you, we're not in any way wanting to sound condescending. But I'm going to tell you, if God be for you, who can be against you? I know in whom I have believed. Do you know who your God is? I know in whom I have believed, and I am persuaded. Come on, say that word, persuaded. Well, let me think about it. No, I am persuaded that the work that he started in me, however recent or however long ago, he's going to finish that work to the very end of my existence. Look over somebody and say, I'm persuaded. The devil's going to say, don't say that. Don't do that. I told you, devil, you hang around here, you're going to really get uncomfortable today. Because we're not allowing your lies and your thievery and your murdering spirit. We're not going to receive that. We're covered. The angel of the Lord encampeth round about us because we know who the Lord is. Amen. Give him praise. Glory. Doesn't mean we're not human. It doesn't mean we don't have thoughts. If I sit all day long listening to the news garbage, I'd be falling apart. I'd be having a nervous breakdown. First of all, you don't know how much of it to believe. Is that a news media person here going back to CNN or Fox to tell them what I said? Sorry. Maybe somebody is going to take a copy of this on the video. We don't trust them, do we? We don't trust them. And so why do I want to let their garbage constantly bombard my thoughts till after a while, what am I going to do about it? Remember, there is a virus out there, and people have become victims and have died, so we've been told, and I think some have. Okay, but that doesn't mean that you here or watching are going to become a victim. You are a child of God. You are a man or woman of God, and you're protected of God. And he said, I'm with you. I'm with you. I want to take authority right now over the spirit of fear, for God has not given you. Let me get down here close to the camera, closer to the people. Fear is not of God. The Bible said it is torment The Lord is not a tormentor. He's the peacemaker. He said, so I didn't come to give you the spirit of fear, but power. Everybody say power. What kind of power? The power of God, victorious thinking, love, and a sound mind. Look over at somebody and said, I'm intelligent. I'm intelligent. The Bible talks about things that we need to decide about what we're going to think about. As a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. We're going to think about the promises of the Lord in his name. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. We have the victory. If you know it, sing it, help me out. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Satan will have to flee. Get out of here, demon. Go help me, help me, help me. Of Jesus. And before me in the pretty name of Jesus, we have the... Sherrell, do you know all that? You don't think she's saying no, she don't want to. Right. But I want to tell you, ladies and gentlemen, God has exalted that name, given him a name above all names, all power in heaven and in earth is in the name of Jesus. Aren't you glad Jesus is the Lord of your life? Amen. So my good friend, you feel tormented. I mean, you just, every day it's depression. You're just struggling. Don't want to get out of bed. Don't want to leave the house. Don't want to do anything. Just afraid something bad. I have a song for you. I just feel like something good is about to happen. Sing it with me. I just feel like something good is on the way. He has promised he would open all of heaven. And guess what? Brother, this could be that very day. When God's people honor himself and call on Jesus. And they look to heaven expecting as they pray. I just feel like something good is about to happen. And brother, this could be the very day. Anybody believe that God didn't do something on Sunday? On this Sunday, sir, ma'am, with all due respect, look, pick yourself up. Look up. Jesus loves you more than you can imagine. And you've just been bombarded and so much negative stuff. Maybe the Lord is just saying you shake this off and begin to give God praise and say, Lord, I want to thank you for hope. If in this life only I had hope, I would be among men most miserable. But my hope goes far beyond all the stuff that distracts me. All right, let me talk just a little bit, not long, on the subject of distraction. You see it here. I ended the last two Sundays reading the instructions that God gave Joshua about the people of God that had been through a 40-year journey of one disaster after the other. There are times when you read the word that God's people, for whatever reason, can go through a deep, dark valley in their life. Now, God promised that he had a land for them, land flowing with milk and honey, so to speak. There'd be cities that would be theirs that they wouldn't build. There'd be vineyards that were growing grapes, and there would be all kinds of fruit that they didn't have to plant. All they needed to do was just go possess it. Satan does not want me to take steps of possession in my life about the promises of God. He wants you to say, like they said, when they got out there and things began to get tough, some of them turned on Moses and they said, "We're disappointed at you. You brought us out of Egypt telling us that you were going to lead us to a place that was beautiful and wonderful. We wish we would have stayed in Egypt. At least we had garlic to eat." Oh, hallelujah. I got garlic to eat. Cucumbers, they said. But you know what? Sometimes you've got to pursue the promises of God. He said, if I will and you will, we've got a combination that is unbreakable. Pursue. I remember, I think I told you this story many years ago. When I was a young guy, my dad built me a shoe shine kit. In those days, I was a teenage boy. They even instructed us and taught us that working was good. And so several of us fellas, we had our own shoe shine boxes, and we did spit shines. Jack, I see you back there, amen. And it was literal, never mind, spit. So we would, there were several of us, and we sort of had our own little territory, and we'd say, "Sir, can I shine your shoes for 10 cents? And at this time, downtown Biloxi was wide open, and it was a very busy place in those years. And lots of people, a lot of military people would go downtown. Now they've taken out the obstructions, and they're rebuilding it to simulate the past. But I remember one day, a fella came, and I said, "Sir, can I shine your shoes for a dime?" He stopped for a moment, looked at me. "Yeah, son, yeah." So he backed up to the building, and I got my little box, and he picked up his foot and put his shoe, and I shined that one. Then he moved and put the other one, and I shined that one. And boy, I spit on it a couple times, and it really looked good. And so I'm done, and I said, "Sir, I'm done. It'll be 10 cents. He said, "Boy, I don't have 10 cents, but I have it over here. Follow me, and I'll go get your money for you." Hey, scams didn't start with Facebook. I'm gullible. I'm a teenage boy. I had just shined the guy's shoes. I'd given my own spit. He's telling me, "Follow me, and I'll go get you dime." And so gullible me, I wanted my 10 cents. And I'm following him. He turns down the street over here, back there. And I'm getting a little nervous, but I'm thinking, maybe we're going to get there. And then he got to a place, and he opened the door and said, "Come on with me here." And I'd never been in a place like that. The smell, the stench was so nauseating. I mean, I was an early teens boy, and I walked into a... Anybody here ever heard of a honky-tonk? I found out later that's what it was. It was a honky-tonk. I had to ask my folks, what is a honky-tonk? The music was loud. It was dark. It stunk. And there were people groaning and moaning and making noises. And I'm following him right through the crowd, pushing and shoving. And it seemed like my journey never ended. And then suddenly, I just made a decision. I'm not following him anymore. This journey is not worth 10 cents. and I don't know what's going to be next. And so I turned and I ran as hard as I could, you know, trying to get through the crowd, get out of the building, and then got in the door, looked around, and by then I was so frightened. I mean, I was just emotionally frightened. And so I went to a payphone and I called home, and my dad answered the phone. I said, "Dad, would you please come get me?" "What's the matter, son?" I said, "I don't know. I'll tell you the story." And so I told him the story, and I could hear the sound of his voice. He said, "You stand right there. I'll be there in a minute." Now, my dad, those of you that knew him, he was one of the greatest guys you'll ever know. But some dude had messed with his boy. So my dad came and said, "Show me where you," he led you. And so I said, "Okay." I didn't know what was going to happen. I didn't, honestly. And so went through the same dark door and smelly place and loud music, and I'm trying to get adjusted. He said, "Who did this to you?" I'm saying, "Well, I'm not sure, Dad." Then I said, "There he is right there." By then, I'm just out of it. My dad got real bold. "Hey, I'm his son. Ain't nobody gonna mess with my boy." My dad walked back to where the guy was, grabbed him by the collar, took his fist and knocked him right upside the teeth. And I'm standing here in total disbelief. I didn't know whether to run for my dad or what to do now. I'm in hysterics. And the fella got back up off the floor and said, "Why'd you hit me?" And he said, "You led my boy through." He said, "Sir, I never saw that boy." And I had given my dad the wrong guy. But the right guy was there. So my dad got a double whammy that day. The point is, I was my dad's son, and he loved me enough that he took charge and he pursued until he got to the place that he could take vengeance. I want to tell you, I belong to him. He leads me. He covers me. He follows me. He protects me. And I'm glad today that I can say, "Devil, I don't have to listen to that stuff. I'm going to tell my Heavenly Father, and you're going to get your teeth knocked out because I belong to Jesus." Aren't you glad you know that today? Amen. Haven't thought of that story in a long, long time. They now had reached the edge of the Jordan. I remember when Peg and I went to the Holy Land trip several years ago. And I was chosen to be the baptizer of all those people that wanted to be baptized. So I waded out. It was cold. Waded out to about waist deep here. And while I'm standing there waiting for each candidate to come, fish that big. And that ain't no, I mean, this is not fisherman's lie. I mean, they were that big. And they were swimming everywhere on top of the water. I thought, even fish here are not afraid. God, give me that kind of peace in my heart. And I stood there, and candidate after candidate would come by. And some of them were preachers. They were pastors. Some of them were church members. And I'd say, "On the confession of your faith, in the name of Jesus Christ, I baptize you." And I put them in that. It was dirty. I mean, it was muddy. But it was God's water. Never call what God gives you common or unclean. That's what the Lord instructed the guy that he said, "Go down and dip yourself, you got leprosy." Sometimes the Lord will lead us to do some uncomfortable things. Now, he probably will not lead me to go in a honky-tonk to witness. Because sure as shooting, when I come out, some church folk gonna drive by and see me come out of the honky-tonk. Let everything be done decently in order. So they're standing by the Jordan. And the elders had gone throughout the 2+ million congregation and said, the Lord said through Joshua to tell you to put your eyes on the Ark of the Covenant. Whatever you do, don't be distracted. And so many of them, making sure. And he said, when you see the Ark of the Covenant move, when you see it, you follow it. What needs to be said, here it is. When you see the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord your God and the priests, the Levites bearing it, then you shall remove from your place and, for lack of a better word, go after it. I use the word pursue. Devil, you try from every angle to misdirect my steps. But the steps of a righteous man are ordered of the Lord because we have our eyes on God. Follow the ark. Pursue your hope. Ladies and gentlemen, though I gain this whole world, do you hear me? Though I gain this whole world, but I lose my soul, what have I profited? What is it that people think is more valuable than a one-on-one personal relationship with God? You that are sitting here today in this building and you that are watching, I'm going to give you a good word. You said it a while ago, you're pretty smart. And I want to agree with you because you understand that making sure that Jesus is with you and setting time each week to gather together. The Bible said, don't forsake gathering together. It's important. It's necessary. And so you that can't get here, thank you for tuning us in. You that are out there that could come, we invite you. We encourage you. Because when you shake my hand, when you shake these people's hand, come here, Robert. Stand right here. How many million people are watching? Look at that camera right there. I'm shaking this man's hand. You see? I'm shaking his hand. I'm going to do something else. I'll get criticized for this. I'm going to hug his neck.
I'm going to hug you back.
This is a brother in Christ. And we can do that because we're in fellowship with Jesus. Thank you, brother. Unless you want to preach to him, you go ahead. There's something about being with people who know Jesus as their Lord. I cannot tell you, as a pastor, when I'm going through a real challenging time, how it's so vital and so amazing how suddenly the Lord will quicken you guys. There you are in my face. And I'm saying, boy, the devil's really giving me a rough time. But I see you. And there have been times that I've sensed in my mind, somebody has been praying for me. And as a part of this local assembly, we encourage each other to pray for each other. For I need the prayers, and you need the practice. We all need to take advantage of opportunity to communicate our love for the Lord. And so here they are. Their eyes are fastened upon the ark because now 40 years, and I said the other day, the journey could have taken less than a month, but it took them 40 years because they were contrary. Some stuff that I go through, it's because I've been maybe a little contrary. But if I'll stay faithful to God, sooner or later, I'll be standing right there where the promises of the Lord are. And he said, when the feet of the priest, the soles of their shoe, touched the water, not before, but the shoe, the soles of the priest bearing the Ark of the Covenant, when they touched the water, not a second before, not a second too late, but immediately at a precise time, the waters just rolled back. And for the next several minutes, next several hours, over 2 million people walked across on dry land. Not only did they cross from the wilderness through a river, but they entered into the promise of God. I want to wrap it up. When this pandemic began, I heard preachers talk about this is the wrath of God. I listened to a lot of them, and I gave serious thought. Is it true because this important, well-known somebody is saying that this is the wrath of God? I decided after prayer and study that I didn't accept that I didn't believe it. I have said from the get-go that this pandemic is the work of the devil to try to cause more havoc on good people. But the Lord, rather than saying, devil, you can't do this, remember when Satan showed up and the Lord said, what are you doing here? He said, I'm looking for somebody to mess with. He said, have you considered my servant Job? He's a perfect and enough. You know what I have thought the last 2 or 3 months? How much the Lord considers you and me as, well, others don't look at it this way, but perfect and upright. Job, actually, as a human, he wasn't perfect. But God could see a place in his life, in his heart, that nobody else could see. And God called him a perfect. Yes. Maybe you need to pull that out of the bag. And the devil's chomping on your ears and telling you all this stuff. Just say, whoa, 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 whoa. Devil, in the sight of God, in the eyes of God, I'm perfect and upright. Now, what do you think about that? What if I ask you right now to turn to somebody and say, according to the word of God, as it was with Job, in his sight, I'm perfect and upright. Do you have that kind of faith? You, sir, you're sitting on the couch at home, your friend or your spouse, whatever, turn to them and say, that preacher told me to tell you, don't mess with me. I'm perfect and upright before him. On these pews, you know who I'm looking at? I'm not looking at the scum of the earth. I'm looking at men and women who have been redeemed by the blood of Jesus Christ. They are forgiven, and Jesus has become Lord of their life. Fill them with the baptism of the Holy Ghost. Redeemed them by his power, and I am somebody. Glory to God. Give the Lord a hand praise right now. To God be all the glory. Now they cross into new territory, and I read it, and let me read it again. This morning, that was only the beginning, to see a river divide all by itself and watch over 2 million adult humans plus the livestock walk across on dry land. That was a phenomenal thing to see. But what that was, it was the beginning of a new day. Here's the deal. This pandemic came to the world. It messed with every planet, every country on the planet, big or little. People fell prey, became sick and died, some. But let me tell you, this time has been an opportunity for the people of God. We have been crossing our spiritual Jordan for the last couple of 3 months, walking into a new place for God to show His glory. But let me warn you, it's only going to be a short time. This is what God has put in my spirit. I'm not predicting that everything's going to be wonderful from now on. It's not. Evil men and seducers shall wax worse and worse. When the police put his knee on the neck of the gentleman the other day and he died, and the whole country seems to be in an uproar because of the death of one man. And my heart goes out to the family. It was not right. But on the same day that this man lost his life, 1,000 innocent babies died because of abortion. I don't see anybody parading around town about that. But I believe that God has said, has given the church a little time. We've been on the edge of the Jordan. We've been making sure all is well. We've been getting close together in the Spirit. And now we are crossing into a place for a season. The Bible said there's a season for everything. A season has its limitations on time. A season for this and this and this and this and this. I believe this virus thing, God has said what the devil meant for harm, as Joseph said to his brethren. God's got a plan. This thing, I believe, has been an opportunity for the church to walk through a place that we've never walked through before. I've never been in my life. I've never been in a time like this in my country and in the world. I've never heard such reports. And so we've walked through turbulent times. But I believe with all of my heart, the church, for a period of time, is going to enter into a new dimension spiritually, where, as Job said, as Joel said in chapter 2, and Peter quoted him in Acts chapter 2, in the last day, saith God, before I come back, he said, I'm going to pour out my spirit on all. So if the church is ready, if our faith is where it needs to be, I believe instead of thinking about all the garbage of CNN and XYZ and PQRS and FOX, F-O-X, we need to have our minds set on the Lord, an outpouring of God. My family, my neighbor, my fellow worker, God is getting me ready and is giving me time to prepare that I can talk about the goodness of God, and there is going to be an outpour of God's Spirit coming in the near future when we get through this pandemic, and I'm talking about the church. And we will rejoice. We will see phenomenal things. We will see miracles that we've only dreamed about, and we will experience God in a great way. And then suddenly, just like that, while we're rejoicing and giving God glory and shouting the victory, we're going to disappear. That's where we are. We're going through our spiritual Jordan through this virus. And God is saying, make yourself ready because you're about to enter. What does it say? Joshua chapter 3. There'll be a space. We've had this space stuff, right? Verse 4 of Joshua 3. There'll be a space. We've had that. And then he said that you will enter into a time, a place where you have never seen before. Never witnessed. And I know I'm in the minority of this persuasion. You listen to the TV preachers and the radio preachers, you won't hear it this way. And I'm not being contrary. I'm being biblical. I believe with all of my heart, revival has been promised. A manifestation has been promised on your sons and your daughters. There's going to be a measure of the Spirit of God, but it will be in a time that we'll rejoice and be out of you. Ladies and gentlemen, if you want to be in the rapture, if you want to escape the judgment of God, what the world has gone through with this pandemic is nothing to compare with when the church gets out of here and the judgment of God begins. This is like a birthday cake. Think about it. Bow your head for a moment with me. The Lord said through Joshua in verse 4 of chapter 3, "For you have not passed this way heretofore." People that are dealing with fear, talk to them. Tell them that's the work of Satan to try to deceive them and mess them up to keep them from participating in the glorious outpour of the Spirit of the Lord. Tell them, quit listening to the negative and let the word of the Lord speak. The Lord said, "I got plans. For you have not passed this way before." Would you stand with me, please? And just bow your head.
The honor, Lord, I lift my hands in worship as I lift your holy name. You deserve the glory. Lord, I lift my hands in worship as I lift your holy name. You are great.
Can you lift your hands with us today all over the building and at home? Yes, sir.
There is no one else.
No one at all like him. What a Savior. What a Savior. What a God that we serve.
You deserve the glory
and the
honor. Lord, I lift my hands in worship.
Why, we do it to worship him. To say thank you. We have hope the world doesn't have.
Oh,
and the honor.
Lord, I lift my hands in worship as I lift your holy name.
That's what we're about to witness, the miraculous of the Almighty God.
There is no one else like you.
Sing it over again.
You deserve great.
He's great.
You do miracles so great. There is no one else like you.
Today, we're going to do what we've not had the privilege to do for a long time. I'm going to ask while they keep singing, how many of you, I hope most all of you, to come and let's just stand together around the altar in closing and worship together. That's beautiful. Here you already are coming. Come on down. Make room. Get close in. Make room for everybody on the way. He deserves the glory. Here we come today to magnify the Lord, to lift up our voice to you, Jesus. Lift my heart. Lift them up. That's beautiful. That's beautiful. Come on. Come closer. Make room around the front. You're great. So great. Miracles coming.
There is no one else.
Sing that part. You are great. You are great. Oh, you are great. Lift your voice. So great.
There is
no one
is like you.
There is no
one else like you.
Oh, yes, Lord.
You deserve the glory.
He deserves the glory. Thank you for our opportunity to mature and grow in the Lord. Soon to witness a manifestation we've never seen before. Help us to keep our eyes on you.
You do miracles.
Eyes on you.
There is no one else like you. There is no
I want to stretch my hand today toward you. Father, you see the people here today that are exercising their faith in the hope of glory. I stretch my hand toward everyone. And I pray that their faith would not decrease, but their faith would increase. And that you'd speak to them in dreams and in songs and study the word. With a freshness, they'll sense a freshness of God in their spirit, in their heart. We're moving forward into this dimension, into this place we've never been before. And I thank you for those that are rallying together. And we thank you for the opportunity to be together today. We pray for those that are not able to join us at this time, but we pray for them too. We miss them. You that are not well, pray for the Raymond family. For a miracle there. My wife and I are leaving shortly after service today, going to Nacogdoches, Texas, to be in the service with Dolly. Her son, Mark Parker, passed away. We're going to make the trip beginning this afternoon to be with that family. And we pray for you today that we're not able to be here. May the grace of God find its way deeply in your heart and life and to all of you. Father, thank you today for the Spirit of the Lord. Surely the presence of the Lord in the house. And you're pursuing us and we're pursuing the Word of God that you've given us. And now we take our leave of just the building. Spirit of the Lord be with us wherever we go. And we give you praise for it and thank you. All of our friends that are watching from all over the country, thank you for them. We pray for them. Those that are not well, both in our local church and in the ministry, live streaming, may there be encouragement come. In Jesus' name. Amen.
You deserve the glory.